snow by tomorrow. But we'll hope that that doesn't happen. Anyway, good morning and welcome on behalf of the session of First Presbyterian Church. I don't know, do we have any special announcements this morning?
Just the two Bible studies.
Okay, the two Bible studies. One is on Wednesday, right, at 10 a.m. What makes Presbyterians Presbyterian? And the same Bible study today, right after
I was 10 years old. Right now, in my left and corrected eye, it is a clear lens. How about that? Because my wife told me, I don't know you without glasses. And so I have a clear lens in this eye, and I have a corrected lens in this eye, and in 3 weeks when I get this eye done, I can see clearly now. The cataracts are gone. It's really been amazing, because if I shut my eye like this, I can see you all clearly. If I do this, you're all a bunch of blurred people. It's just amazing. And as I was thinking about that this week, I thought, you know, in the scriptures, it says if anyone's in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. My left eye. The old has passed away and the new has come. But not my right eye. And I thought, you know, isn't that like us? We accept Jesus as our Savior and our sins are forgiven. We are a new creation. But until he comes again, we still have an old eye. And so when we confess our sins, what we're essentially saying is, Lord, I forgot to look through my good eye this week, and I did some things with my bad eye, and I'm so sorry. Will you forgive me and continue to work in me to make me complete and whole and brand new? And the good news of the gospel is he always says, yes, I will and I am, and the good news is you will be made new once again. Thanks be to God for this great news of his love and his grace in our life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our song of response today is going to be on page 2036 in your blue books. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Let's stand and sing. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Service, we continue to worship by presenting to the Lord our tithes and our offerings, but we're not doing that just yet. We will, but still to present ourselves, our tithes, our offerings to the Lord, thanking him for all that he has given to us and asking him to use a portion as we give it back to him so that the good news of his love and grace can go forth from this place into this community and into this world. The plates are on the back table as you leave, so we just simply ask that you place your tithes and offerings there, and that helps the life of the church. Let's stand together and sing the doxology, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God.
see what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites. So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all the words that the Lord had commanded him. Am I the only one that hears that echo?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you. Second reading, the gospel lesson, is from Matthew chapter 7. Verse 21 to 29. It's in the New Testament of your Bible, Pew Bible on page 7. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out our demons in your name? And do so many deeds of power in your name, then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoers. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on a rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. Now, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I didn't hear an echo either.
Oh, good.
But sometimes.
It must just be in my head.
That's great. Well, today we are beginning our third week of our all-church study. It's been a fun study. And just so you know, we have about 35 people between Dayton and Polson who are studying the same material each week, and they're reading all the lessons, and they are getting together in groups. Normally, we'd be doing a small group study. We'd be meeting in homes during the week to discuss all this. But because it's what it is this year, we're doing classes at church instead. And I think it's been a good process for us, good information for us all to have. The first week was about how Presbyterians organize themselves to get the job done. What I've discovered in my life is whatever the organization is, whether it's a church or a business or a school or an athletic team, whatever it is, there's an organizational structure that exists to help get the job done. It's sort of like our bodies. You know, there are technically, I think, seven systems within our body. There's breathing system, there's the blood system, there's the nerve system, there's all that. Some of you could probably tell much more about it. And there's a skeletal system. Well, if you take the skeletal system away, we collapse into a blob and we don't get anything done. But if you take the other systems away, all you have is a skeleton and it doesn't go anywhere. They have to work together so that the body can function as it was designed to function. Organizationally is the skeleton for the body. Remember, the skeleton exists for the body to do its work, not the other way around. And so as Christians, as people in a particular church, the Presbyterian system exists to help the people of God to get their work done, to get the work of God's kingdom done. It's simply the way that we go about doing it. That was the first week. The second week, last week, remember, we didn't have the communion elements here. We put building blocks on the table. Right, Aaron? Building blocks from the nursery on the table. And each building block had a word that described describe something the Presbyterians believe. And we put different colors around them so it wouldn't be just the word, but we got the texture of the color of what we are building. And depending on which blocks you put on the bottom, where you stacked all the rest of them, it took different shapes, and it took different forms, and it took a different visual presentation of what we believe. So then we went back and we said, these are the things that Presbyterians believe. We put down four big building blocks and two on top. That was the first half of our discussion. This week, we're going to take a look at the second half of that discussion, the last five essential beliefs that we as Presbyterians tend to emphasize in our life as Christians. The way I want to talk about those last five beliefs today, for us, whether you're in the classes or not, is to talk about being on God's team. Okay? How many of you have ever played team sports? Oh, lots of you. What are some of your team sports that you played?
Softball.
Basketball.
Basketball.
Rugby.
They only play that in the United Kingdom. Scott, come on. Rugby. Soccer, absolutely.
Basketball.
Yeah. Basketball, yeah.
Ice hockey.
Ice hockey.
Tennis. Volleyball.
Tennis is... Okay, we got to take a vote. Is tennis a team sport?
Doubles is.
Depends on if it's a doubles or not, right? Doubles, it's a team sport. Otherwise, it's just all you lonely people out there one-on-one with the rest of the world. Team sports are a great thing. We learn a lot from team sports. And I believe that God is a team sport player. Now, let me explain. From the very beginning of Scripture, what do we have? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God being a team, right? And so we look at the earliest pages of Scripture, Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning, God. But then you see that it was the Spirit of God that moved across the face of the waters to begin creation. And then when it got to creating people, the way it says it in the Bible is, God said, let us create man in our own image. In the image of God, let us create them, male and female, let us create them. God called himself us, a team, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So when I look at the Scriptures, I look at God as being a team player. And so it goes all the way back to the very beginning. So the question, if God's a team player, is what is the desire of that team? What does God want to accomplish on that team? And as I look at the Scriptures, what I see is that God wants to accomplish an intimate, personal, and loving relationship with we who are the highest point of God's creation. God wants a personal relationship with us. And the way I get that is in Genesis chapter 3, when, you know, we always talk about when Eve ate the apple and gave it to Adam and he ate the apple and then they... Here's what God was doing. God came down in the cool of the afternoon to walk with Adam and Eve in the garden. The way that it's said in the Scriptures, it implies that this was a common thing that God wanted to do. God came to have fellowship with us and friendship with us, to invite us into God's world. That's what God wanted. And he said, the only thing that will ever break my heart and my heart's desire to walk with you is if you choose to disobey me and go to another source for your spiritual life. And of course, that was the temptation that the serpent gave to Eve in the garden. Hey, go ahead and eat the apple. We know God said don't eat it. Go ahead and eat it. You're going to like it. It's going to be wonderful for you. Yeah, it may break your relationship with God, but don't worry about it. God just worried that you're going to become a serpent. And so she ate the apple. Now, I've always thought she got a bum rap. Any of you women think that Eve got a bum rap in the garden? You know, so she blew it. She ate the apple first. You know, Adam didn't eat the apple first. Well, where was Adam? It says in the scripture that Eve ate the apple and turned around and gave it to Adam to eat. He was right there. He didn't say a thing. I can just see Adam saying, I think I'm going to let her go first and find out what happens. Right? But what happened was they began to feel shame. They began to blame each other. They began to carry a load of guilt. And they began to feel the pain of being human that God had never wanted his children to feel. That was the brokenness of what took place when they rebelled against God. So what did God do? God did some incredible things. First of all, God worked to redeem them. And so the way he did that is at the end of Genesis 3, he took a little lamb and he sacrificed the lamb so that the lamb would then make an atonement for their sin. And then he took the skin of the lamb and he made clothing to cover their shame. And then he sent them back out into the world and said, I'm going to send you out of my garden, but I'm still going to love you. He redeemed them, he sought to reconcile them, and then restore them to the type of relationship and intimacy that God designed for God and human beings. That is the heart of God, and that is the work of God's team. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and then for the team that God built. The first person God put on the team was Abraham. Remember Abraham? And Abraham's promise from God was, hey, look, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to lead you to a land that's going to be flowing with milk and honey. It's going to be a wonderful land. You're going to be my special person. And what I want to do with all the blessings that I give you is I want you to bless the rest of the world. Pretty good assignment. That was the first person that God selected to be on God's team. And then it grew from there. The passage we read from the book of Exodus today was several generations down the road. But God said to the children of Israel, I want you on my team. Pretty incredible that God wants people on his team. God could have done it any way he wanted. He could have waved a magic wand and made all the bad stuff go away. He could have taken and said, okay, you've done made a mistake. I'm wiping everything else and going to start over again from scratch. But what God chose to do is say, I am going to share my love and grace with people so we can restore the relationship that's been lost that I want my people to have. And so God chose the children of Israel to be on his team, primarily to be the spreaders of that good news to the rest of the world. Now, I love the passage. One of my favorites in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament, because God says this to the children of Israel through Moses. Know therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. The whole earth is mine. You shall be my treasured possession. Just think about that. You know, in America, we spend gazillion dollars in our public school systems teaching the building of self-esteem in children. We want to build them up. These are three wonderful young people that we have in us today, and you deserve all the building up that you can possibly have because you are wonderful people. But I want you to know this. The creator of the universe, the one who created everything we see, looked down and said, these are my treasured possessions. Everyone, look around in this room. So you move your head around. I want you to make eye contact with somebody. Okay? And now I want you to say that on three, okay? You are God's treasured possession, okay? One, two, three. You are God's treasured possession. That's what God said to his team. You are God's treasure. I love everybody. But amongst everybody, you are God's treasured possession. And then he went on to the second thing he said to him. You shall be for me a priestly kingdom. What does a priestly kingdom do? A priest is an individual that stands between God and people. They get to know God and love God, and then they get to bring God and tell everybody around them about the God they've come to know. The other thing a priest gets to do is what we do every Sunday when we ask for joys and concerns. We get to take all the people we've come to know and the hurts and the struggles of their lives, and we get to bring those to God and say, here they are. A priest stands between God and people, bringing God to people and people to God. That's what God said, my team is going to do. Isn't that incredible? When Jesus was here, Jesus created a team as well. Does that surprise you? Those 12 men and the numerous women who gathered around him, he said, you're going to be on my team. I'm going to die for the sins of the world, but you are going to be on my team. You're going to learn my ways. You're going to learn my strategy, and then I'm going to send you out to be the people who will tell the world about God's love and God's grace for them. Today, when we come to the Lord's table, we're going to remember that we are part of God's team. In fact, when we take a look at the elements of communion, what we see is communion is the renewal of being on God's team. Baptism is the entrance. So when somebody's baptized, God's saying, okay, you're on my team now. You're going to wear my jersey of water on your forehead, or if you're immersed, water all over you. You're going to be on my team. But every time we come to the Lord's table and we take the bread, and we take the cup, we're saying, I am recommitting myself to being on your team. That's what this is all about. We are on God's team. And because we're on God's team, we are renewed regularly through the sacraments that we celebrate. If we went down the list of other things that are part of God's team, stewardship is a part of God's team. God said, this is my world, and I'm going to give you the responsibility to oversee it. Remember the old hymn? This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the beauty of the spheres. This is my Father's world. We'll stop right there. It goes up too high for me. This is God's world. God created it. Each step of the way, God said, this is great. And now I'm going to put you in charge of my world. Stewardship is an important part of being on God's team. And a stewardship of the time that God's given us. He's given us each a number of days. What do we do with those days? God's given us spiritual gifts. What do we do with them? God gave them to make his world a better world and his church a better church. God gave us all sorts of resources and said, be stewards of the gifts that I give you and make my world a better place. We could also say that sin is a reality within being on God's team. Any of you ever make a mistake being on God's team? Higher. We all have. The reality is this side of eternity, we are not going to be able to play God's team and God's game of life 100%. We all fall short. And the reason why we confess our sins every week, or if you're like me, every day, or if you're like me, many times during the day, it's because once I sin, my relationship is broken, and I don't want to have a broken relationship with God. Therefore, I humble myself, and I say, Lord, I'm sorry once again. Get me back on the right path so I can be a good player on your team. That's what we're going to talk about this week. Those are essential elements of our faith. And just like Jesus said at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, which Becky read this morning, talk is cheap, Anybody can say those things, but you're supposed to get out there and do those things. And if you do them, your life, your house is going to be built on a rock. And the storms of life will come. And isn't it nice to say, to know that Jesus didn't say, if you follow me, you're going to live happily ever after, you're never going to have any problems. No. He said, if you follow me, the storms of life will come. But because you built your life on the rock, it won't destroy your house. Other lives, they will. The storms will still come. But if you built on the rock, you're in a much more secure position. And that's what he wanted us to do, because he loves us. And so, my friends, my hope and prayer this morning as we come to the table of the Lord is to remember we are on God's team. Being on God's team, we are tools, we are the priests, we are the proclaimers that God wants to redeem the world, reconcile the world, and restore it to that intimate, loving relationship that he desired all of his creatures to have from the very beginning of time, and will be the hallmark of what heaven will be like when we leave this world and join him in all eternity. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for wanting us on your team. Sometimes I think that's a bigger problem than you ever thought, but you still want us on your team, and you want us to know what your team's about. And you want us to live by the standards and the principles and the commitments of the team, so that the world can know your love, can experience your grace, and be restored to the type of people you designed from the very beginning. Thank you, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I like to take, when we come to the Lord's table, I like to take off my coat and put on my robe. This robe reminds us that when we come to this table, this is not about us. This is about God's gift to us. These sacraments are God's gift to us, to renew us, to restore us. And we remember what it costs for us to have these gifts, because we remember that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body which is broken for you. This do as oft as ye eat it in remembrance of me." And after the disciples had eaten the bread, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." And the early Christians added, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember the Lord's death until he comes again." And the good news is, he is coming. Thanks be to God. And now we are going to take the two trays, and we have these special. Do you want to do the demo?
Yeah, sure.
These are specially prepared, germ-free communion cups and bread.
Difficult to get into.
So there's the little clear plastic that you pull back on the very top. It's kind of hard to get apart sometimes. And then the wafers in there, and then you have to bend this little thing. These are a little different than the last one.
But keep them
really
sharp.
Keep it bend them, and then it'll come off, and hopefully the juice isn't.
And what we'll do is we'll have you come forward first, then you can walk around back that way, and then we'll have you come to the center aisle and head back. So come and receive the body and blood of our Lord, which was shed for you.
Thank you.
would take the wafer. Always like to remind us that the body of Christ reminds us of our humanity, not just his humanity. We are broken people. We are humans. And yet, he broke his body so we could have new life. Take it, the body of Christ broken. If you take and peel back to the cup, I know it's a challenge. The new covenant in the blood of Christ shed for us, take and drink. And let's pray. O Lord, you brought us onto your team, and we're grateful. The waters of baptism remind us that you claim us as your own. And just like Lord Jesus, when you were baptized, the voice from heaven says, "This is my beloved child, whom I love." Lord, coming to this table is a renewal time where we take you into ourselves afresh. We need your presence in our life. We need to have the mind of Christ. We need to be empowered by the Spirit of Christ. We need to have the fruit of the Spirit to live as you would have us live each and every day. And so as we have now taken you into ourselves afresh, may we leave this place and be the example that you would want us to be. For truly, as someone once said, you may be the only Jesus Christ a person ever gets to meet. Help us to be you in our world. We pray this, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen. We close our service today. Our closing hymn is, "Now Thank We All Our God," which is a wonderful song of celebration for who we are as God's children. Let's stand together, page 361. So I had to choose another hymn down there, but forgot that they were different. They're still a great hymn. "How Firm a Foundation, Ye Saints of the Lord."
Foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in God's excellent word. What more can be said than to
empower you. May the love of Christ surround you.